Okay, so because we're getting close to the end of the term here, right? We only have five class meetings remaining after this one. I do want all of you to be thinking about your final papers. So if you have not yet decided on what you want to write about, it's probably a good idea to get those wheels turning at least, right? So, you know, if you want to talk through an idea, please do come and talk to me. Also, once you've figured out what you want to write about, I want to remind everybody, as a starting point for your research, right? I post bibliographies on GeorgiaView in the folders for each individual text or sort of discussion point that let you know what sources I've consulted in preparing for class. So you can certainly use those as a starting point as well. Now, there are also a couple things to be aware of as you're doing your research for this course, because everything we're looking at is in translation. Sometimes things aren't transliterated into English in quite the same ways. So today's poet, for example, right? The name he's given in the anthology is Li Bo. But if you are actually looking to do your research paper on these poems, you need to know that he is also sometimes called by other slightly different names, right? So if you run across references to Li Po or Li Bai, these are all the same poet. These are just different ways of reading the same Chinese characters, right? So similar thing if you happen to be working on the 1001 Nights. You may actually turn up more if you search for sources on the Arabian Nights. Right. Lots of these authors have kind of alternate names. Lots of these texts have alternate titles. Sometimes those alternate titles will be given in the introductions in the Norton. Sometimes they won't. So if you're having trouble finding sources on a particular thing and you think this might be the reason, please do come and talk to me. Like, if you're having trouble finding sources, come talk to me anyway, right? But just so you know, this might be the sort of thing that'll jam you up. Okay, so does anybody have any questions? Yes, Emily.
We're not allowed to do the paper on what we presented, right?
No, it has to be on something different.
Okay.
Anything else? Nope. All right, well, as things arise, as I said, please do keep in touch. So today we're going to be looking at probably the characteristic poet of what is sometimes referred to by Western historians as medieval China, but I actually really kind of dislike that formulation, right? The term medieval refers to a specific period and set of social structures in Europe from the fall of the Roman Empire to about the beginning of what we call the Renaissance, right, or the early modern period. So I'm going to see, I know your textbook uses it, but I'm going to ask you to throw away the term medieval when discussing the history of a culture to which it doesn't really apply. Instead, when we look at Chinese literary history here, we're going to be talking in terms of dynasties. And the dynasty that we're discussing here is the Tang. You'll sometimes see this spelled also with a little apostrophe after the T. The Tang dynasty lasted from the 7th into the 10th century and is often regarded as a kind of cultural high water mark. right? So while medieval Europe is mired in tiny little petty kingdoms, having these little conflicts, right? Intermittent religious wars, very, very weak centralized states. China is a unified, prosperous, and relatively harmonious empire that is producing much of its best art and music in this period. Right. This is part of the reason why I don't like the term medieval for talking about this period. Like, it's a completely different set of circumstances. Now, one interesting thing that happens in the Tang Dynasty, right? Let's think back to when we talked about the Analects and the Tao Te Ching, right? When we talked about Confucianism, in order to be a good Confucian, how do you need to measure yourself? What? How do you know your place in the grand scheme of things?
Relationships.
Yeah, your relationships with other people, right? What's most important is society and where you fit into that society. Right? Your social ties to parents, to children, to superiors, to inferiors, to friends, right? That's what's most important. That's what defines you. That's what defines your duties in Confucianism. So the basic idea in Confucianism, right, is to achieve harmony with others. Now, what about Taoism? Pardon? Yes. Be the branch. Yes, be the branch that bends but does not break, right? What are you supposed to find harmony with in Taoism? Do your relationships with other people matter all that much according to the Tao Te Ching? Not so much, yeah. In fact, other people may be distractions as you try to find the way. What are you trying to live in harmony or in balance with in Taoism?
Is it nature?
Yeah, you're basically trying to find a kind of balance with nature. And while Confucianism is social, Taoism tends to be much more individualistic in practice. Now, in the early Tang period, a third belief system, which is in some ways compatible, particularly with Taoism, is promoted within China as well. Right. This is when Buddhism, you know, there were already Buddhists in China before the Tang Dynasty. But early Tang rulers promoted Buddhism. They funded the construction of Buddhist temples. They encouraged people to practice Buddhist rituals. They, you know, made prominent Buddhists into sort of court favorites, right? Buddhist scholars were given special privileges. And Buddhism was really kind of revolutionary in the context of Confucian China, because in order to be a good Buddhist, in order to achieve Buddhist salvation, what do you need to do? Yeah. Not only do you have to give up your worldly possessions, right? You are also expected to cut all of your social ties. or at least those that are based solely on social standing or on biology, right? So when a Buddhist decides to take vows as a monk, he shaves his head, thus altering the body that nature gave him. It's kind of a Confucian no-no. You reject all ties, you change your name, so you no longer carry on your family name. You become celibate, so you're not going to pass on the family line. And you give up any claim to family property. So during the Tang period, Confucianism goes into decline. And Taoism and Buddhism, both of which focus on individual salvation, and which celebrate the hermit and the monk as ideals, become politically and culturally very fashionable. So, the poet that we're looking at here today, Li Bai, or Li Bo, we have relatively little reliable historical information about. There's stuff about him that people have tried to extract over time from his poems. Right. For example, we don't know for sure that Li Bo was an alcoholic, but he sure as hell writes about wine a lot. Right. There's a story of his death that focuses on three of the most common images in his poems, right? The moon, a river, and wine. And supposedly he got so drunk one night that he saw the reflection of the moon in the river, and he tried to embrace it and fell in and drowned. There is no evidence that this actually happened. He was also known for his attachment to Taoist alchemy, and so probably died from ingesting too much mercury. One of the fun things about Tang Dynasty Taoism, right, is that it's very much tinged with magic and sorcery. The goal for a Taoist in this time was to, much like, this is probably influenced by Buddhism, in the introduction of Buddhism, the goal was to try to transcend your weak, ephemeral, mortal form and turn yourself into an immortal. And so, in order to do that, you would often consume things that you knew were poisonous, like, say, lead and mercury. Because by poisoning this body, you would be strengthening your immortal, transcendent body. Li Bo's not around to ask how that worked out for him. But that was the goal, right? Transcendence of the mortal world, of the mortal form. And so one of his other characteristic images is of climbing a mountain. And this is meant to represent that Taoist progress towards transcendence. So, things we do know about Li Bo. That he was very well read. We can see this from the number of literary and historical allusions that he makes in his poems. You know, they're allusions that wouldn't mean much to us, but that would have meant a hell of a lot to a Tang Dynasty contemporary. We also know that despite being very well educated, he never took the imperial examinations that were the quickest path, to social advancement. Right, I think we talked a little bit about this when we talked about Confucius, right? That if you wanted to get ahead in Chinese society, you studied poetry, you studied history, you studied ritual, you studied rhetoric, and at the end of your studies, you took a test, which included, for some time, the spontaneous composition of a poem. And if you did well on the test, then you would get a place somewhere in the imperial bureaucracy. And this would provide you with a job, with standing, and with access to influential people. So particularly from a Confucian point of view, this is a very, very important sort of thing to do. There are a couple of reasons why Li Bo might not have done so, despite being of the right social class to do it and the right educational background. One is that, as a Taoist, he rejects all this shit. The other might be that at the time Li Bo lived and wrote, there was a good bit of political instability in the Tang Dynasty, and a lot of government officials would shine very, very brightly for a short time and then be exiled, castrated, or simply beheaded. So if you failed to please the emperor within the imperial bureaucracy, your fall could be swift and very, very painful and humiliating. We also know that he was reputed an excellent swordsman who killed a number of men in duels when he was young. And we know that he married at least four times. Though we don't really know too much about what became of all four of those Mrs. Lees. So, in Chinese literary history, he's developed this kind of reputation as a sort of doomed romantic figure. Right, he has the same kind of reputation in China that a poet like Lord Byron, say, has in English literature, right? As this sort of, rebel against the society in which he lived, who was just sort of doomed to keep beating his head against the wall until he went off wandering in exile and finally died the way he lived, drunk in a river. He's often referred to, in fact, in Chinese literary history as the banished immortal. The idea being is that he's clearly someone not of this world, or who could not properly fit into this world. So he must have been banished from the heavens for some kind of offense. So that's Li Bo. What'd you think of these poems?
They're interesting.
Okay. What'd you find interesting about them, Alexa?
The way his style of writing for poetry is very different from Westernized poetry.
Okay.
And it seems like sometimes he implies things through imagery rather than being descriptive about things.
Okay. Can you give me an example?
Like the moon, drinking alone
with the moon. Okay. Sure, Leah, let's go there.
He doesn't actually like establish a scene or like where he is. He just starts mm-hmm. by saying a pot to fall among the flowers.
Mm-hmm.
I drink alone with my moon. I raise my cup to invite the moon. He and my shadow and I make three.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. He doesn't like get uh-huh. a drawn out description of what's going on.
Okay.
I liked him. He was very short, sweet,
and
to the point.
Yeah, one thing that we find in a lot of Chinese poetry, and also in a lot of Japanese poetry, which is heavily influenced by Chinese poetry, is a real kind of economy of expression. Right. They make a conscious effort to convey a feeling or an idea to you through a particularly evocative image rather than through any sort of kind of discursive explanation of states of feeling or things like that. You don't really get much internal reflection in a poem like this. The way the poet feels or what the poet thinks is conveyed largely through these kinds of externals. And a lot of these externals are conventional. For example, this favorite image of Li Bo's, the wine that flows so freely in his poetry, to a Chinese reader in this time would convey a couple of things. One, luxury. Wine was expensive. Not only was wine expensive, it was arguably a waste of resources that you could use for making food. So wine is a luxury, it's an extravagance. Wine also tends in Chinese poetry to refer to companionship. Drinking wine is supposed to be a social activity. This is something that you do with your friends. This is something that you do in company. It's not something that you're supposed to do by yourself. Wine is something to be shared. So the fact that Li Bo is drinking alone is itself a kind of subversion of the typical meaning of this symbol. Right, so a pot of wine among the flowers, I drink alone, no friend with me, I raise my cup to invite the moon, he and my shadow and I make three. So he's arguably not really alone here, right? He invites his shadow, which is merely a reflection of himself, and the moon that creates the shadow to join him in this imbibing, right? The moon does not know how to drink. My shadow mimes my capering. But I'll make merry with them both, and soon enough it will be spring. The moon does not know how to drink, my shadow mimes my capering. So what that the moon doesn't know how to drink? Given the conventional meaning of the wine symbol, what does this tell us? Yeah, this is a reference to like being here with the moon, right? With this remote bright disk in the sky doesn't actually cure the feeling of loneliness. And what about the shadow? What does the shadow do? Yeah, all it can do is imitate his movements. So the moon remains remote, the shadow can only imitate, can only mime. But I'll make merry with them both, and soon enough it will be spring. Now spring is also a kind of conventional trope in a lot of Chinese poetry. Now, in Western poetry, what does spring typically mean? What does it refer to?
Flowers and sunshine.
Rebirth. Flowers and sunshine and rebirth, right? Yeah. This is the season when everything starts anew, right? Planting season. The green comes up out of the earth. When spring is described in Chinese poetry, it's actually meant to evoke a feeling of sadness, believe it or not. Because while all of that beauty of nature comes up in the spring, right? Everything is reborn. It's going to be reborn for a short time only. So spring in Chinese poetry usually refers to ephemeral beauty, beauty that fades, beauty that's not going to last. It's here for an instant and then gone. Now it might also be a good idea to think about what the moon represents as well. Not only is it a remote object up in the sky, but the Chinese calendar is lunar. So the moon also measures the passage of time. So we have two things here in the poem that refer to the inexorable passage of time, right? We have the moon and we have the spring. Yeah, Kayla.
Well, I've also heard that like the seasons can represent like periods of your life as well in other religions.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that's true in Chinese poetry as in other forms of poetry. Yeah, barren winter is old age. Autumn is, you know, autumn is middle age. Summer is when you're in your prime. And spring is youth, right? Which, I'm sorry for all of you, is also kind of that most fleeting period in our lives, right? And we're really, really conscious of it once it's gone, believe me. Yeah, so... Yes, it can also refer to youth, but it has those same sorts of connotations, right? Of youth that is beautiful in the now and is going to wither and fade. Good times. I sing, the moon moves to and fro. I dance, my shadow leaps and sways. Still sober, we exchange our joys, drunk, and we'll go our separate ways. Let's pledge beyond human ties to be friends and meet where the Silver River ends. So if we look at the movement in this last stanza before the couplet, what's the only thing here that's actually moving?
Yeah.
Yeah, he's the only thing in motion, right? Everything else only looks like it's moving in relation to him. The moon is actually perfectly still. His shadow only does what he does. So what that he's the only thing moving, given what the moon is supposed to represent? What's he doing here? He seems to be, right?
Like, you're talking about how, like, he's lonely and sad.
Uh-huh.
And, like, it's supposed to be this terrible thing. I took
yeah.
this poem in the complete opposite direction. Like, he's enjoying mm-hmm. being with the moon. Like, it's a good thing. He is content with himself where he is.
Yeah.
And he does not need anybody else.
Mm-hmm. Well, what I'm pointing out here actually are the conventional meanings of the tropes that he's using in the poem. That does not mean that the way you're reading the poem is wrong. Because what Lee Bow often does is take these conventional tropes and play with their meanings. Right? So maybe it's good that beauty is ephemeral, right? Maybe it's good that the moon is remote and far off. And yeah, he is having a good time here by himself, dancing with his shadow. But the point is here, right, again, that the moon represents the passage of time. And the speaker in the poem is the only thing moving. Everything else is still. So if we think about what the goal of a Tang Dynasty Daoist was, why is Li Bo drinking all that mercury? Yeah, trying to at least live forever in a transcendent body, right? The idea is, yeah, to practice certain austerities in order to transcend your mortal form and live forever. And what he's doing here, drinking the wine in companionship only with himself and the moon, is transcending these physical limitations. One of these physical limitations being time, right? Essentially, if you are immortal, that is exactly what you have done, right? You have transcended time. Time doesn't mean a damn thing to you anymore. Yeah, Darlene.
Okay, so like, I could see this going both ways then, because we were talking about how he was the possibility of him being an alcoholic. He says, still sober, we exchange our joys, drunk, and we'll go our separate ways. Does that mean, like, once he's drunk, he's to the point where he's transcended, or I'm not transcended, once I'm drunk, there's a certain line to keep it fun and joyful?
I think the more he drinks, the more he thinks he transcends. Okay. I think it's moving in that direction. Right? Because, again, remember the action of potion drinking, right? What that's supposed to do. I think that the wine here is associated with these longevity potions, as well as with these other conventional connotations. Let's pledge beyond human ties, right? Transcendence again, to be friends and meet where the Silver River ends. So the river is another favorite image of Li Bo's, which does things that are kind of similar to what the moon is, right? The moon is inexorable passage of time, right? Measures the course of months and years. And a river flows inexorably in one direction. So where that river ends, right? The end point of time. The end point of distance. The sorts of things that once you're a transcendent immortal, you don't care about anymore. All right, do we buy that?
Well, you could kind of read it as like a liminal space too, because it
okay.
Dumps into the ocean, so you can kind of read it as transcendence there.
Okay, yeah. And remind everybody, since it's been a while since we've used this word, I think, what liminal means, what a liminal space is.
Where two spaces meet, like a shore of ocean,
mm-hmm.
and the water, or like the horizon and earth.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. This is, a place where water and land meet, a place where river and ocean meet. So it is one of those sort of nowhere kind of spots where worlds tend to cross each other symbolically. So yeah, I think that actually makes a lot of sense. All right, anything else anybody wants to say about this particular poem, or any questions anybody has about this particular poem? Well, let's move on to another. Which one do you guys want to talk about? Oh yeah, Will.
just a random question. What exactly is hoarfrost in the quiet night?
Okay, hoarfrost. I mean, essentially, hoar is frost. H-O-A-R.
Right.
Yeah. So that's...
It's just frost.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Although hoar, H-O-A-R, also has associations with old age. So you might see in some older English language poetry, it's an archaic word, right? We don't really use it anymore. You know, when winter shakes his hoary beard, right? It's meant to indicate both frost and old age. Yes?
What are the six dragons in the verse poem?
Okay, the six dragons, this is, it's a conventional sun chariot image. Chihe is the sun goddess, or like the goddess who is the physical embodiment of the sun, right? And this is not something that's specific to Confucianism or Taoism or Buddhism. As we've talked about before, none of these religions actually require gods at all. But they do adopt sort of folk deities that had existed in the popular imagination before any of these three religions had become prominent. So Chihe is one of those sort of deities who kind of predates any of these religious systems. But it might actually not be a bad idea to look at the way he uses the idea of the sun and the sun goddess in this poem. So actually, since you brought us here, would you be kind enough to read the poem for us?
The sun comes up from its nothingness, seems to rise from beneath the earth.
Bless you.
Passes on through heaven, sets once again in the western sea. And where, oh where, can its team of six dragons ever find any rest? Its daily beginnings and endings, since ancient times, never resting, and man is not made of its primal stuff. How can he linger beside it long? Plants feel no thanks for their flowering in spring's wind, nor do trees hate losing their leaves under autumn skies. Who wields the whip that drives along four seasons of changes? The rise and the ending of all things is just the way things are. How do I say that?
Chihe.
Chihe, why must you always drown yourself in those wild and reckless ways? What power had Rie that he halted your course by shaking his spear? This perverts the path of things, errs from heaven's will. So many lies and deceits, I'll wrap this mighty mud ball of world all up in a bag and be wild and free like chaos itself.
All right, thank you very much. Okay, so how does he describe the action of the sun here?
It's perpetual.
Yeah, perpetual cycle, right? And he's also anthropomorphized it, right? So he's turned it into a sort of humanized image, right? That it's, okay, it's a chariot driven by a goddess, hauled by six dragons. And what do you what point is he trying to make with the sun image, do you think? Okay, yeah, day in, day out, same thing happens, right? The sun never stops. It always makes exactly the same journey from east to west. So it's similar to the way the moon is used as a kind of conventional image, right? Eternal passage of time. But on the one hand, it is both linear time, right? Chronological time, but it's also eternal because it's perpetual. Right? He's linking chronological time and eternity in a single image. And then what purpose is served by making this image a goddess in human form? Yeah, that a god is a human-like being that has transcended the limitations of ordinary humanity, that doesn't have to deal with the limitations of ordinary humanity, right? Essentially, a kind of perpetual, eternal body. And man is not made of its primal stuff, right? So the first half of that first stanza is describing the sun and its perpetual action. Man is not made of its primal stuff. How can he linger beside it long? Plants feel no thanks for their flowering in spring's wind, nor do trees hate losing their leaves under autumn skies. Who wields the whip that drives along four seasons of changes? The rise and ending of all things is just the way things are. So what does he shift to in the second half of the stanza?
That life is what it is.
Yeah. The plants don't get upset that they die. Oh, I don't know, has he ever talked to one?
But then, like, isn't that kind of what he gets to in, like, the second half, where he's talking about, like, you know, you're so worried about, you know, the wild and reckless waves, like, the stress of the day, what's going on, all these lies, all these deceits, don't worry about it, just be wild and free.
Be wild and free indeed, yes. Let go of these worldly cares, right?
Eat, drink, and be merry.
Yeah. There is, there's a lot of, and again, like, I hesitate to sort of place Western ideas onto texts that wouldn't have recognized them, but there is a lot of what we call, like, a carpe diem theme in Tang Dynasty poetry. Right, everybody knows what carpe diem means? It's Latin for seize the day, yeah. Now, in Western poetry, this usually has a kind of sexualized implication, right? I don't know if any of you have ever read, there's a poem by Andrew Marvell, a very famous 17th century poem, it's called To His Coy Mistress. And the basic point of the poem, right, is like, look, if you and I had perpetual time to be together, right, I would take things slowly and worship you the way you deserve to be worshipped. But we don't have perpetual time, we will not be young and beautiful for very long, so let's just get things over with, shall we? That's the basic thrust of the Western carpe diem poem. In Chinese poetry, it's much more sort of generalized. It's less about having sex with your object of desire right now, and more about sort of generally letting go of societal restrictions and enjoying life. So there is some of that, but yeah, I think what we have here paired in this first stanza, right? In the first half, we have the eternal. And in the second half, we have again the ephemeral, right? We have that which is permanent juxtaposed against that which is going to fade. Chihei, Chihei, why must you always drown yourself in those wild and reckless waves? So while the sun pursues its course the same way every day, why does it matter that the waves in which the sun chariot drowns at the end of the day are wild and reckless? We've got something that follows this very, very steady course across eternity that every day descends into the wild and reckless. What does this suggest the natural tendency of all things is towards?
Chaos.
Back to Ovid, right? Similar idea. Even the orderly sun in its perpetual cycle drowns itself nightly in the roiling sea. So chaos always comes to dominate order. Right. What power had Liu Yang that he halted your course by shaking his spear? Right. This is very similar to the story of Joshua, and I think it's the book of, is it the book of Numbers, where Joshua and his armies are invading Canaan, and in order to win a battle, he holds up his hands and the sun stands still for a single day, right? Yeah, this is a very similar myth. You know, a warrior named Liu Yang is able to threaten the sun in order to make it stop in its course. So we have here a myth about a man halting an eternal natural process, right? Getting in the way. Hey, eternal sun, this guy shook his spear at you, and you stopped. So this is another one of those Daoist hints creeping into the poem, right, of how human beings can mess with what looks like the natural order of creation, right? That it's in fact possible for human beings to stop nature in its tracks. This perverts the path of things, errs from heaven's will. So many lies and deceits. I'll wrap this mighty mud ball of a world all up in a bag and be wild and free like chaos itself. So I think what we have at the end of the poem is like a total destruction of and disregard for regularity. Right. Being regular, orderly, stable, and sober in your habits is no path to immortality or transcendence. If you actually want to make it all the way up that celestial mountain, you got to break the rules. You can't simply live in the way that has been decreed for humans by nature. Embrace the wild and free. Do what you want. Wrap up the world in a bindle and become a great celestial hobo. All right. We got a couple other poems here that I think, you know, we got maybe 10 minutes to talk about. So is there one more that really struck you guys?
Bringing the lines, kind of a,
okay.
A pretty big contrast with
drinking
alone with the moon.
Okay. How so? Where do you think it's a contrast with drinking alone with the moon?
Well, you know, down there near line 25, hey Master Chen and Ho Dengji, mm-hmm. Bring in the wine. And so he has friends drinking with him now.
Yeah. This describes a social gathering, not the sort of lone search for whatever it is he's searching for when he's drinking by himself at the moon, right?
What is to say that drunk and never sober?
Well, and you know, this is another actual, this actually allows us to point to another conventional poetic association with wine. For a Chinese poet, wine also means inspiration. There's a legend, for example, about an emperor who had never in his life composed a line of poetry, but one night he got drunk and suddenly just spontaneously rattled off an amazing poem. So wine is all of these other things. Yeah, it's something you drink with your friends. It's, you know, it's an extravagant thing, but it's also something that inspires eloquence. It inspires bravery, drunken courage. Yeah, sure, I'll fight you. I don't care that you're 7'2". That's what's going on in this poem, is wine as source of not just social bonding, but also of inspiration. Right. So if you look at the whole thing here, we'll start at the top of page 1025, right? Look there. The waters of the Yellow River coming down from heaven rush in their flow to the sea, never turn back again. Look there. Bright in the mirrors of mighty halls, a grieving for white hair, this morning blue-black strands of silk now turned to snow with evening. So we have the image of the river again. And then what's the second image he gives us?
He's aging.
Yeah. It's that same feeling I get when I look in the bathroom mirror in the morning and I see gray hairs in my beard, right? It's like, shit, I'm getting older. Right, so the river and the gray hairs, right? This time image again. Time and aging. For satisfaction in this life, taste pleasure to the limit. And then we're shifting to this carpe diem theme, right? The river's always gonna flow. Your hair is gonna go gray. So taste pleasure while you can. And never let a goblet of gold face the bright moon empty. Heaven bred in me talents, and they must be put to use. I toss away 1,000 in gold, it comes right back to me. So boil a sheep, butcher an ox, make merry for a while, and when you sit yourself to drink, always down 300 cups. Hey, Master Chen, ho, Deng Wei, bring in the wine, keep the cups coming, and I'll sing you a song. You bend me your ears and listen, the bells and the drums, the tastiest morsels. It's not these that I love. All I want is to stay dead drunk and never sober up. The sages and worthies of ancient days now lie silent forever, and only the greatest drinkers have a fame that lingers on. Once long ago, the Prince of Chen held a party at Pingle Lodge. A gallon of wine cost 10,000 cash. All the joy and laughter they pleased. So you, my host, how can you tell me you're short on cash? Go right out, buy us some wine, and I'll do the pouring for you. Then take my dappled horse, take my furs worth a fortune, just call the boy to get them and trade them for lovely wine, and here together we'll melt the sorrows of all eternity.
Nope, not alcoholic.
What's that?
Nope, definitely not alcoholic.
Well, see, here's the thing with poetry, though, right? The speaker in a poem is always, at least to some extent, an invented personality. The poet is always wearing some sort of mask. And not all writing is necessarily autobiography. So without other documentary sources to back it up, it's hard to say whether or not he was really an alcoholic, especially given the things that we know, the other things that we know wine is supposed to symbolize, right? But what is he interweaving here with all this talk of wine?
Luxury and extravagance.
Luxury and extravagance, yep.
Like, enjoy the luxuries of life, you're not going to have them forever.
Yeah, well, in particular, enjoy the wine, right? Enjoy.
Man, I'm certainly not going to praise an event where the wine costs $10,000 a gallon. I'd rather upset with that price personally.
Well, yeah, well, especially, you know, given that, you know, these days, you can actually get a pretty good cheap bottle of wine at the food line, right?
But isn't that the whole point of the poem? Like, why go ahead and spend the money? You're gonna die. What are you gonna do with it when you're dead?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You don't need your dappled furs. You don't need your horse. You don't even really need friends. As long as you've got wine, right? Keep the wine flowing, and I will keep spouting out lines of poetry to entertain you, right? It's worth your while, guy throwing party, to keep me happy and drunk, because then I will keep you entertained. And we may as well seize the pleasure while we've got it. Indeed. But yeah, so most of these poems, right, you see the pattern here, right? They're mostly about the passage of time and trying to cram as much living as you can into the passage of time, or finding ways to transcend time, right? And this is no different here, right? He says it's the great drinkers that outlive everyone else. Now, I think there's a pun there on the Taoist longevity potions, right? Remember that wine is not the only thing that Li Bo imbibes regularly. Yay, Mercury. Yay, Cinnabar. Yes, if you ever see references to Cinnabar in old alchemical texts, that's lead. Yep, they're actually drinking lead.
Well, it doesn't kill you.
Well, that's
it
the
does.
Thing, it did. It does.
But it didn't kill him right then.
No, no.
Well, it doesn't kill you, gives you cancer later on in life.
Yeah, yeah. And that's the thing, like, again, like, they knew it was going to kill him, right? They knew that you should not be drinking lead if you wanted your physical body to survive. But the idea was, yeah, that the longevity potion was not for the physical body, it was for the spiritual body. And, yeah, I could probably go on and on about elemental interactions in Taoist alchemy, but that would probably just confuse and bore you, and we're running out of time anyway. So... does anybody have any further questions about any of this?
I have a question regarding papers.
Go for it.
Material that's covered in class, if we want to incorporate that into our papers, how would we cite that?
By and large, you can consider that common knowledge.
Okay.
Because at least if you're paying attention and taking notes, all of you know that.
Okay.
All right, anything else? All right, then go ahead and turn in your in-class writings. I'll give you back your last ones. Oh, and I have